And I want to minister this morning on the four realms of the prophetic. Because I don't want you to get hurt. Because there's a lot out there that is called prophecy that is really demonic. And we have to discern the difference between both. Because God wants to speak to his people. And the people said,
amen.
All right, now just quickly write these down. Where's your Bible? You're an usher, I see. Oh. Well, you're also a saint. You need the word just as bad as they do. Go get your Bible. You have it close by? Well, then you better get a piece of paper and write what I'm gonna give you. Hey, be glad I'm not your pastor. Hey, listen, I was a very tough pastor when I was a pastor. If anyone, for example, walked out on me while I was teaching, I'd lock the doors on them. I did. Oh, brother, these were the days. All right, number one. The first realm of the prophetic is called the, please hear this, the word of prophecy. And the word of prophecy has no human mixture. Because the word of prophecy is the scripture. The second realm of the prophetic, now I'm going to go back and deal with these one by one to help you really understand what I'm talking about. Because I truly believe the Lord will be speaking to his people prophetically in the coming days. And the reason I'm saying to you all this is because I'm seeing it happening in some parts of the country and some parts of the world already. It's happening quite intensely. And anyone walking in the Spirit will be under that anointing very quickly. All right, the second realm of the prophetic is called the spirit of prophecy. So first you have the word of prophecy, then you have the spirit. And the spirit of prophecy is the atmosphere of the prophetic that people can come under and God will begin to use them. And I'm going to say something here to kind of wake you up. I know you're awake, but this really shake you up. Even unbelievers begin to prophesy under the spirit of prophecy. You got to be careful with that one, okay? I'll explain that. I'll give you scriptures. The third realm of prophecy is the gift of prophecy. And the gift of prophecy has its limitation. The gift of prophecy is to be is an operation among the saints of God. It doesn't go beyond the border of the church. Then you have the office of a prophet. And the office of a prophet, it has no limit. Now let's go back and talk about each one by itself. Every believer knows already that the Bible is prophetic. God speaks through his word, through types, through shadows. God speaks through his word, through the life of individuals. God speaks through his word, not only through the life, but through what happens to that individual. Let me give you an example. Joseph, he is a prophetic voice of Christ. If you look at the life of Joseph, there you see hidden the life of the Messiah himself, the life of Jesus. Example, loved by his father, just like Jesus. Hated by his brothers, just like Jesus. Sold, just like Jesus. Placed in a pit, just like Jesus. And the pit speaks of the Lord's death. Then placed in a prison, just like Jesus, when he went into the underworld. Then coming out of prison, just like Jesus who rose from the dead. Then given all authority in Egypt, just like Jesus, who sat at the right hand of God, Joseph sat at the right hand of Pharaoh. It's all a hidden type of the Messiah. How many understand? Say yes. And then Joseph was given what? A Gentile wife, just like Jesus, who what? Received the church. So the Gentile wife is the church. So when you look at the life of Joseph, it's prophetic. Or Isaac, prophetic. Isaac going to the mountains of Moriah. Isaac carrying wood, that's the cross. And there's so much in the life of Isaac. One of the most amazing ones to me in the Bible. And people don't seem to, you know, sometimes realize that the prophet Daniel was also prophetic in many things that God did with him and through him to do with the Messiah. Now, that's a whole study. I don't want to bore you and keep you here all day, but I think it would be fascinating for you to study the lives of these men and see how Jesus is revealed in certain ways, sometimes more fully in one than another. But like Job, amazingly, a lot of what happened to Job was prophetic about the Lord. Or Jonah, things like that. So when I say the word of prophecy, I don't just mean where the Lord speaks clearly, thus saith the Lord. I also mean through types, through shadows. The word of prophecy would be things like the feasts of Israel, all prophetic about the Messiah. Or the tabernacle of Moses, all prophetic about the Messiah. The tabernacle itself will blow your head off if you begin to study it. Let me give you one example. The Lord said to Moses, he said, I want you to put these pillars around the tabernacle. And each pillar was to be covered with silver, like a cap of silver. Then capped on the bottom with brass. Now, if you study the word of God, you find something amazing. Wood is symbolic of flesh. Flesh, your body, huh? The Bible says wood is symbolic of physical flesh. The Lord said to Moses, I want a pillar. That means a man. And I want to make sure that that wood is acacia. Acacia, why? Because acacia is like olive wood. It has a long life. So acacia in the Bible is symbolic of eternal life. So think about wood that's eternal. Well, there's only one man who rose from the dead, whose body, who is life eternal himself. So here we see Jesus in the wood. Then amazingly, God said, cap it with silver. Well, if you look at the Bible, silver is always redemption. So he's our redeemer. On the bottom, brass. Brass always speaks of suffering. He is my Savior. Redeemer and Savior. Wow, huh? But here's something even that'll blow your head a little more. He said, I want you to tie, put a little knob, and connect a rope to it, but make sure the rope is all made of goat's hair. Now, that's in the Bible. Now, people read that, and they just pass right by it, have no clue what they read. Well, they need to know what it says, because it's all about Jesus. Goat's hair, what does it represent? Prophets. Always prophets. But now, the Lord said something amazing. Most Christians miss it altogether. He said, I want the goat's hair to have 11 strips. Why 11? Because the number 11 is the number of destruction. What is destroyed is always 11 in the Bible. Always. Now, one more thing. Goat's hair not only is symbolic of prophets, it's symbolic of sin, deception. You seem to have forgotten that the Bible talks about Michal, David's wife, who covered what with goat's hair? Remember? It's always speaking of something to be that you use for deception or sin, goat's hair. And then the Lord said, tie the other end of it to a nail, brass nail, and make sure it's only halfway in the ground. Now there's the whole gospel in a piece of wood, silver, brass, rope, and a nail, the whole gospel. The perfect man redeemed me, saved me. He is the prophet of God who became sin and destroyed it. All in the rope. And wait. Who died, the nail, and Jesus is called the nail in Isaiah, who died, but God said something amazing. He said, make sure to only put half of it in, meaning he will rise again. Now you say, well, how did you find all that stuff? I read the Bible. You study the Word, simple. And you see Jesus everywhere. Never read the Bible to get information. Get it? Read it to get revelation. It's not information, it's knowledge, his knowledge. It's not about knowledge, it's his knowledge. Say his knowledge. I'm not interested in getting knowledge. I want to know his knowledge, the knowledge of the Lord. I want to know him, not just knowledge. Knowledge fills your head, but the knowledge of God changes your heart. We want the knowledge of God, not just knowledge. Well, when you look at the tabernacle, you see the prophetic. You see the gate. Can you handle more? I'm sure you can. Hey, he's your pastor. I'm sure you can handle way more than that. The tabernacle has seven revelations. The gate, the altar of sacrifice, the laver, lampstand, table of showbread, table of incense, ark of the covenant. These are seven revelations of the Lord, all in the tabernacle. You know, God is so detailed. There are no meaningless details in the Bible. Say that. Say, there are no meaningless details in the Bible. Okay, so the Lord said to Moses, he said, I want you to build the gate, and I want it to have four colors, purple, white, scarlet, and blue. Well, if you look at the Bible, purple is always symbolic of what? Royalty, majesty. White, perfection. Scarlet, suffering. Blue, heaven. So here you have the Son of God. He's the purple. He's the king. The white, perfect man. Scarlet, suffering savior. But then you have the blue, Son of God. These are the colors of the gate. So he is the gate. You know why the Jews got angry? Very angry one day when he said, I am what? The way, the truth, and the life. You know, these are the names of the entrances to the Holy of Holies. Because the gate is always called the way. The door to the holy place is called the truth. And the veil to the Holy of Holies is called life. So they got really angry at him when he said, I'm the way, I'm the truth, I'm the life. I'm the gate and the door and the veil into the presence of God. Well, you know, you say, well, how do you find all this? Well, you got to study. You got to dig deeper than just reading Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, you know. You got to go deeper in the Word of God. And it's all prophetic. It all reveals the Lord. The altar of sacrifice speaks of his blood, the work of Calvary. The laver speaks of his sanctification, his word. The lampstand, light of the world. Table of showbread, bread of life. Table of incense, his priestly office, and then the Ark of the Covenant, he's the glory. But you know, you've got to read all this, and of course, look, it takes a lifetime. I am sharing this with you to just get you a little hungry. To dig a little deeper in the Word, okay? Now, that's called the Word of Prophecy. Say the Word of Prophecy. And the word of prophecy is all God. In other words, there's no human mixture in it. It's all the Lord. He's the one speaking. He's the one revealing. And the Bible says in 1 Peter, in fact, why don't you read that, please, for me. I'm going to give you the scriptures. I like doing that with you because it helps you participate. All right? All right. 1 Peter, want you all to read with me. Oh, hallelujah. 1 Peter chapter 1, chapter 1, verse 20, 21. Okay? That's 2 Peter. Did I say first? I meant to say second. 2 Peter chapter 1. I don't really speak Spanish. I just know hallelujah. Well, anyways, just trying to be funny, but it's okay. All right, 2 Peter chapter 1, and I want you to read out loud, read verse 20, 21. All right, let's begin. 1, 2, 3, go. Knowing this first, that no prophecy of the scripture, here we go, the prophecy of the scripture, the word of prophecy, is of any private interpretation. For the prophecy came not in old time by the will of man, but holy men of God spake as they were moved by the Holy Ghost. So here you see very clearly in these two portions, in these two verses, that the word of prophecy, here called the prophecy of Scripture, has no human mixture in it, okay? Now, let me go on to the second one, which is the spirit of prophecy. And I want to really help you understand this one, because it happens often and people don't know what's going on. The spirit of prophecy is the atmosphere of the prophetic mentioned in 1 Samuel 19. Now remember the story. David runs away from Saul. He goes to a place called Naioth, where Samuel had a school of the prophets. And Samuel is ministering under the anointing when suddenly the prophetic begins to move. Samuel is ministering. That's what always stirs the prophetic. When people start ministering, it stirs the prophetic. So under the anointing, when someone is speaking and ministering and the power of God is really flowing, amazingly, God begins to talk to people. Because they come under the mantle of the prophetic, because a man is ministering the anointing. Now remember that Saul sent soldiers looking for David, right? What happened when they came under the umbrella of the prophetic? They all began to prophesy. Remember that? 1 Samuel 19. And then he sent another group, right? And what happened to them? They all prophesied. Then he sent another group. What happened to them? They all prophesied. What happened? They came under the umbrella or the atmosphere of the prophetic. Then Saul came himself, if you remember. And he came to a well, which was about a good 7-8 miles away from where Samuel was. And he began to prophesy miles away from where the man of God was. Then when he got there, what did he do? He stripped himself off, took his clothes off, laid down naked day and night, prophesying. You say, well, wait a minute. How could he prophesy laying naked? Very good question. The atmosphere of the prophetic can cause a man to speak God's word while being demon-possessed. Absolutely. Absolutely. Even though living in sin, his mouth becomes pure. God begins to use his lips under that atmosphere while he himself is not walking with God. So the atmosphere of the prophetic, people can say the right thing and not live the right life. God can use their mouth only, but not their hearts. I will never forget when I used to go to Catherine Kuhlman. Oh, dear God, You know, there's a lot about the anointing I've learned over the years. I've been in this 43 years, I've learned a lot. One thing about the anointing I've learned, I hope this doesn't mess you up. It's possible to be anointed and be involved in witchcraft at the same time. Well, like Balaam. Don't remember Balaam? Yeah, he was involved in witchcraft, yet could prophesy and could bless and curse, and God would actually back him up. It is possible to be anointed. Oh, you won't like this one. It's possible to be anointed and be called the devil. Judas. Jesus called him a devil. But he was anointed to go lay hands on the sick and anoint them with oil and see him healed. Because the, you know what, I'm going to teach on this at 2:00. I'm going to teach about the seven dimensions of the anointing. Ooh. Then I'm going to lay hands on people. That's why I didn't want to. I asked the pastor if we can do that thing in the next building. It's easier for me to lay hands on people when it's smaller, you know. I don't have to work so hard. I want God to anoint his people. But the anointing of God there's many mysteries to the anointing of God, you know. But the anointing of God, let me say it like this. This is going to help you, okay? Say after me, there is an anointing in me. And please say, in me means my spirit. Yeah, so there is an anointing in you. And the anointing in you deals with your spirit life. So that anointing is in your spirit. Now repeat after me. There is an anointing on me. That means on my soul and my body. That's a whole separate anointing. The anointing on your soul and body comes when God uses you. The anointing in you is there all the time. 1 John 2:27 talks about the anointing inside of you. It says that abides. Abides means it doesn't leave. Right? The anointing abides. 1 John 2:27. And that anointing comes at salvation. And that anointing produces three things. Number one, hunger for the Lord. Number two, faith in God. Number three, love for the Lord. The anointing in your life, in your heart, in your spirit, man, the minute God saves your soul, the anointing comes with that, salvation. At salvation, God anoints your life, not your body, your life. And when he anoints your life, meaning your spirit, man, you become hungry for the Lord. You begin to believe his word. Faith is born with that anointing. And then you love him. Now, the word of God makes it clear it is possible to lose that anointing. You can lose the one in you. Okay? You cannot lose the one on you. The one on you comes later as you prove yourself faithful. See, when people are living for the Lord and that anointing in them, there's hunger, faith and love, and the living for the Lord, and the serving the Lord, and so on. It won't be long before God will trust them with a ministry. That's the anointing on their office, really. When I say on you, I mean your office. So the anointing comes on the individual, which affects the intellect, emotion, and will. Because under the anointing for service, people become very intense, you know, and everything gets magnified under that anointing. And that anointing comes and people get healed because of it. And that's the only anointing you can transfer. Like your pastor just had me pray over a handkerchief. The anointing can be transferred, but not the one in you. You can't transfer the one in you. You only transfer the one on you. Comprende? I love it. Now that anointing on you will never leave your life. Once God gives it to you, it's a gift forever. It's a gift. Okay? It's a gift. God will not take the gift back. So it is possible to lose the anointing inside of you and the Lord walking away from you and keep the anointing on your ministry. That's why many will come in that day saying, Lord, Lord, we prophesied in your name. And he'll say, what? I don't know you. That's a very puzzling thing that he'll say, I don't know you, because the fact is he did know them. But you find something about the Lord as you get to know him. You discover what his nature is like. When the Lord dismisses a man, he dismisses him out of his memory. Absolutely. So when the Lord said, I don't know you, because he dismissed them from his memory. It says in 2 Samuel 1, 21, as though he was not anointed them. When God dismissed Saul, he dismissed him from his memory to never again mention his name. So much so when he talked about him to David, about Solomon, he said, I will not remove him as the one before him. But he never said who was the one before him. Because the Bible says when you walk away, he will never take your name on his lips ever again. That's scary, you know, that the Lord says, I won't even mention your name. So when God dismisses someone, he dismisses them from his memory too. So he says, I don't know you, because he doesn't. He dismisses them. So it's possible to have an anointing on your ministry and not on your life or in your life. But when the anointing is flowing, the anointing on a ministry, it stirs the prophetic. And people begin to hear the Lord, and he begins to speak to them, in fact. And the most amazing things begin to happen. Suddenly, because of that stirring, you'll be sitting next to someone and say, hey, I just feel the Lord's going to heal you today. Suddenly, there's a lot of talk between people, and they start to feel things about each other. Or they'll say, you know, the Lord is just, you know, letting me know this about you. Because of the prophetic, it's called the atmosphere. Are you learning anything? All right. Now, there's a third one. I got to deal with this one. You know, I may go back to the second a little bit just to help you a little more, but let's see how the Lord leads us here. The third one is the gift of prophecy. Now, the gift of prophecy works only inside the borders of the church and is limited. It's limited to what? It says that gift of prophecy is for edification, exhortation, and comfort. So when God begins to activate that gift in people's lives, they are given that gift to edify or to exhort, meaning to stir up, or to comfort, means to strengthen. The word edify means to energize. Think about prophets can energize your faith. Or you start believing for things you had not believed for before. And then to exhort means to stir the faith. So you energize your faith, then it stirs your faith. And the word comfort means to strengthen, to establish, to give it longevity. So the word, this blessed gift of prophecy, contains memory. If you forget what the guy said, well, how can you be strengthened tomorrow? How can you be edified when the problems show up? See? So when someone says, thus saith the Lord, and frankly, I gotta say this, I don't know that some of you will like that, but there is no thus saith the Lord with that gift, because it's not the Lord that's speaking. It's the gift that's speaking. You gotta hear this. There's a big difference between thus saith the Lord, yet the Lord using the gift. Well, you know by the Spirit that God is saying such and such to an individual. Now, people like to add thus saith the Lord to give it a little credibility, you know, a little strength, so people pay attention to it. It's fine. You can say thus saith the Lord, because in fact the Lord is the one speaking anyways. But he's imparting that knowledge to the spirit man. Now, when you use thus saith the Lord, it's the office of the prophet. And that's why, you know, sometimes it's good when you teach, you know, to explain the difference. Now, please listen carefully. The gift of prophecy has been misused. First of all, someone says, the Lord tells me you're going to die. Please. That's not the Lord. Because the gift of prophecy is for what? Edification, exhortation, comfort. So when someone speaks negatively, you must break it right away. You must say, I break those words in Jesus' name. And you have to break them by speaking it. You don't do it by thinking it. You got to say it. No weapon formed against thee shall prosper, and every tongue that will arise against thee in judgment, thou shalt condemn. You have to speak it. This is the heritage of the servants of the Lord, which means those who belong to God have that authority to break it. Because if you don't break it, it'll come your way. You have to speak and say, I break those words in Jesus. I will not accept it. Now, let me also say something else here. The gift of prophecy has nothing to do with the future of an unbeliever. You know, there's a lot of people going around, well, the Lord shows me Trump is going to win. Really? Or Hillary. That has nothing to do with the kingdom of God. The Lord is not going to speak to you about politics. It only deals with the redeemed. And the plans for the redeemed. Did you hear that? The moment they go outside the border and start to talk about the futures of movie stars, it's witchcraft. Because if you stay with the Bible, it deals only with the redemption, the redeemed, their life, not the life of an unbeliever. Read your Bible, it's all there. The only individuals, now listen carefully, please. The only individuals that dealt with the futures of an unbeliever, and even there, it had to be connected to the plan of redemption for Israel. The only individuals that dealt with the life of unbelievers were the prophets like Isaiah, Ezekiel, or Jeremiah, or the others. But when they talked about Nebuchadnezzar, when they talked about Cyrus, or any of the other kings, or Pharaoh, it dealt with the plan of redemption for the people of Israel. Now, they went outside the border of edification, exhortation, comfort, because these prophets had power to bring down and build up. That's the office of a prophet. Now, let me tell you something. There's not a whole lot of prophets I know. I don't like it when they call themselves prophets. I think it's ego. I'm prophet so-and-so. Really? I'm happy for you. A prophet is God-ordained, not self-ordained. Or ordained by a group of people that want to, whatever, make him feel good about, you know, about himself. A prophet is called of God. The prophet I know, there are prophets I knew, people like Oral Roberts, he was a prophet. Pastor Yonggi Cho, a prophet. Billy Graham, a prophet to the nations. Because a prophet deals with the destiny of nations. Every time you look at a prophet's anointing, whether it's Isaiah, Jeremiah, Ezekiel, Hosea, Joel, any of them, they dealt with the destiny of Israel. Amen. Or the nation, or another nation's future that was connected to the destiny of Israel. Or they judged Israel wrongfully, or they mistreated the Jewish people. When God spoke against Edom, why did he speak against Edom? because the Edomites were enemies of Israel. Or he spoke against the Moabites. Why? Same reason. Or he spoke against Esau, Edom, okay? Or when the Lord gave a word against the Egyptians, or when the Lord gave a word against the Babylonians or the Assyrians, it always had to do with the way they treated the Jews. It's a fact. God deals with the nations as the nations deal with the Jews. Never forget what I just said. Every nation to this day, God deals with them the way they deal with the Jewish people, including America. So, the prophetic, it's very important to understand that the gift of prophecy. By the way, where is a clock here? I don't see a clock. It's up there. Ooh, that's too far for me. I can't see that far. I got to tell you, this is so funny. Jan Crouch and I were doing Praise the Lord one time, and this guy kept showing us, you know, a little board of how much time we have left, and she's as blind as I am, so we're all nearsighted, you know? You know, I can see close. I can't see far. So Jan said, Benny, what does it say? I said, I'm just as blind as you are. I have no clue. So, well, anyway, so, that's the way you do it. Just do this. Okay, now please hear this because this is important, okay? The Word of God makes it very clear that if you go outside the borders of edification, exhortation, comfort, if you go outside the borders of redemption and you start to predict the future of movie stars or politicians, you are treading on dangerous grounds. This is predictions, not prophecy anymore. This is witchcraft. This is demonic now. Nothing to do with God's plan for His people. So please, ignore people. Don't even bother to read their books if they predict the futures of people outside the church. Stay safe. Because that can pollute your mind. And I don't want to see your minds polluted. Let me hear an amen. Okay. And when they come with the gift of prophecy, it's for what? Edification. And edification, edify. To edify means to what? Build you up. Uh-huh. And to exhort means to stir you up. And to comfort you means to strengthen you and give it longevity. Means that word that you hear will stay with you. Do you know that to this day, I remember words I was given when I was in my 20s. Because they still strengthen me. They still edify me. They still exhort me. Because if you don't remember them, how can you be edified? Who are you? You are such a sweet lady. Is this your shofar or his shofar? Your shofar. Well, don't blow it now, brother. Maybe later in the next room. All right, now you have the fourth, and the fourth is the office of a prophet, and I think I explained that, but let me just say one more thing about the prophet. The office of a prophet, whether it's the Isaiahs, the Jeremiahs, the Ezekiel, so these men have power to go beyond the limits of edification, exhortation, comfort, because they can speak death. They can speak life to a nation or an individual. Don't you remember Elijah the prophet? Well, he was in that realm. He was a prophet who could speak life and death. And he did. Elisha, same thing. He was a prophet. Big difference between Agabus and Elisha. Agabus had the gift of prophecy. Elisha had the office of the prophet. So you see it in the Bible very clearly, where Agabus came and edified the church to prepare them about some famine coming. But it was a word of strength to prepare, you know. So the gift of prophecy will prepare you for something that may be coming to strengthen you, to exhort you, to protect you, and so on. But that prophet, like the Jeremiah, like the Elisha, like the you know, Isaiah and Elijah, they have amazing power to speak life. You know, I will tell you, I'm stunned by how the Lord saved my life through dear Oral Roberts. You know, he and I met regularly because he was my neighbor almost, lived 20 minutes away from me. I was on my way to Liberia, and I had gotten an invitation from John Jimenez, who sent me an invitation, but with the invitation was a letter from the president of Liberia. Before all that mess happened there, now they have a new president. So I always wanted to see Oral, and I would say to him, would you pray? Can you let me know what the Lord is saying? Should I go or not go? And when the anointing would fall on him, just a certain look came on his face, and he would stare at you, you know, make you scary. Like, oh my God, what is he thinking? What does he see, you know? So he looks at me with those big eyes of his. He looks, says, you go to Liberia, you'll come back in a casket, and God will judge you for dying early. I said, I'm not going. Cancel the trip. I'm not going. But exactly a week later, they had a big war there, and the president who invited me was toppled. And had I gone, I would have been probably shot by somebody who didn't like him, because he was going to use me to stay in office. And Oral Roberts saw that and said, you better not go. Well, he didn't say those words. He said exactly what I told you. He said, you go, you come back in a casket. Boy, I heard that and I began to shake. I said, I'm not going, brother. No way, Jose. But he was a prophet who could speak life. And he spoke life to me by saying, don't go die, you know? No way. That is a prophet. How many understand the difference? Put your hands up high. But it takes a lifetime to come to that place where God ordains you as a prophet. Now, I want to give you just a few quickies on how to get the prophetic working inside of you. So it'll take me minutes. Okay, write this down, please. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I want to hear a hallelujah. Hallelujah. Lift your hands and tell the Lord, I'm ready for use. I'm ready for service. Okay, well, the Lord heard you. All right, number one, please write this down. Please realize that prophecy was a vital part of the life of every believer in the book of Acts, because it says that the Holy Spirit filled them and they prophesied. They all prophesied. Remember that? So to prophesy is a vital part of the life of every believer. God Almighty wants you to prophesy. And many of these scriptures are in Acts 2, 16, Acts 19, 6, Acts 21, I should say, verse 9. I'll repeat those. Acts 2, 16, they were filled with the Spirit and prophesied. Acts 19, verse 6, they prophesied. Acts 21, verse 9, they prophesied. Every time the Holy Spirit fills them, they prophesy. 1 Corinthians 11, 5, we see again, this is the work of the Holy Spirit. Number two, you cannot activate the gift, the prophetic, without releasing faith, stepping out. And I'll have a little more to say about this in just a moment. Let me just say quickly, prayer and fasting activates the prophetic. So when you pray and fast, you release it. Number three, you cannot understand or live or activate the prophetic without learning the operation of the anointing. You have to learn how the anointing works. The prophetic always is released three ways. When the glory, which is the presence of God, manifests, and the presence of God manifests in worship, the presence of God manifests in communion with Him, fellowship with Him, and it manifests through the Word. When the Word is revealed by the Spirit, the Lord manifests, His presence manifests. Many of you, when you worship the Lord, He becomes more real than life, right? At that time, the prophetic flows. But the prophetic will not flow, even then, the prophetic will not flow unless, please hear this one. This is very important. You have to discern the thoughts of the Holy Spirit, meaning you have to discern the strength of the wind at the moment. So before you prophesy, make sure the wind is blowing just for that. That's why it says we're to be quiet and wait for the spirit of prophecy to begin moving upon us. It's like knowing this is the moment to prophesy. In other words, do not prophesy when your pastor is preaching, because the Holy Spirit will not be speaking through him and you at the same time. That's confusion, see? So you have to wait for the right moment to prophesy. I went to a church years ago. I got to tell you this. I went to a church in Malaysia, Kuala Lumpur, and I was amazed how the pastor had people prophesy, and they would worship and worship and worship and worship and worship, and then they would stop and allow the prophetic to begin moving, and people would come and take a microphone and prophesy one by one. I was quite impressed by that. That was the church where Joseph Prince was the music director. And Joseph Prince told me, he said, "Benny, it's all your fault." I said, "What do you mean?" He said, "When I was the music director in Kuala Lumpur, you laid hands on me and knocked me down." He said, "You knocked me out, so it's your fault." I said, "Okay, thank you for the compliment." But anyways, that was the church he came out of in Kuala Lumpur. That was prophetic, there was powerful anointings there. And the pastor would have people come and prophesy after about a good hour of worship. So that's why when the Lord becomes real, the anointing starts to flow and the prophetic becomes easy. But this man knew that, you know, he didn't want his people to prophesy while he's preaching or teaching. So he would just let them come and do it while there was no one else talking. And it was very, very powerful. I never forget this. How accurate the word of the Lord was that night was just magnificent. We need to see more of it. Let me hear an amen. Amen. So just quick here, and I'm almost done. Jim, you can come help me. Thank you. So learn to operate under that anointing and wait for the right moment. But then before you release the prophetic, wait under the anointing for a specific word, and you may sense, like Jeremiah 20 verse 9, fire, or you may sense joy in your spirit, because the word to prophesy means to bubble. There's actually joy that kind of springs out of you. So when you begin to feel a certain fire, and I don't mean fire like hot, you know, heat fire, I mean like a stirring. Did not our hearts burn, it says, while the Lord talked to us, Cleopas said. So you begin to feel that stirring, you know, you've got to say it. You almost can't hold it back. And then you feel a certain joy. Remember Psalm 45 verse 1, my heart is entiting a good thing, or bubbling. Wait till you feel that bubble. It's the only simplest way I can say it. And then wait till there is intensity in the atmosphere. Are you learning anything? Yeah. I'm giving you points on how to release the prophetic. Learn till there is that intensity where the, if I can call it this, the mood of the Spirit. You have to learn the mood of the Spirit before you prophesy. And finally, stir up the gift. And we stir up the gift by stirring the word of prophecy in us, the word. The word stir is the gift. And the word is the foundation of the gift. You know what I want to do today? It's almost 1 o'clock, right? Yeah. What I want to do today, for those that'll come to the next building, I really feel I need to lay hands on them. Am I allowed to do that over there? Because I want to see God begin to use his people. Somebody say, praise the Lord. I'll be ministering on the anointing, and I'll be praying for this, for the sick as the Lord leads. I have a flight at 6:25. I hope I can make it still. If not, I'll just take the later flight. But lift your hands, pray in the Holy Ghost. Come on, out loud. I want to hear you. Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit. Thou art welcome in this place. Holy Spirit. Blessed Holy Lord, thou art welcome in this place. Omnipotent Father of mercy and grace, thou art welcome. Thou art welcome, Lord. Thou art welcome in this place. Holy Spirit, lift your hands and welcome him, saints. Welcome in this place. Holy Spirit, thou art welcome in this place. Omnipotent Father of mercy and grace, thou art welcome in this place. Fill all the hungry and thirsty within. Restore us, O Father. Revive us once again. Holy Spirit, thou art welcome in this place. Holy Spirit, thou art welcome in this place. Omnipotent Father of mercy and grace, thou art welcome in this. Before we leave today, before we leave, I'm gonna just take a few moments and pray a healing prayer over you, that the Lord will heal you. I won't have the chance to lay hands on anyone. I'll just pray over you. Is that all right?